Well, hey, everybody. Welcome back. Sorry I didn't get a study in yesterday. It's been a nutty week. But we are going to pick up here with the last three trumpets, which are the woe trumpets. And this is when Satan is on the earth. Okay, this is his announcement of his arrival after he's booted out. And the events that will be happening, and then the bowls of plagues, the vials, will be poured out. The mark of the beast will be happening during these three seals, and it's going to be quite action-packed from here. So, with that said, I'm going to do a little recap on the previous trumpets, just real quick, and but before we do, I want to talk to you about tribulation. We need to really think about, what is tribulation? What is God doing when he allows tribulation in our life? And first, we have to start with the definition of tribulation so that we can comprehend what is it and why do we go through it and what's the plan. And that's where we're going right now. Because it's the whole basis of this book. It's the whole basis of our faith, everyone. It's really important that we understand it. So the word tribulation, it is in the Old Testament and the New. So the first time it's mentioned is in Deuteronomy, I do believe, yes, Deuteronomy 4. And it talks about your tribulation. And it's even applying for today. It's first mentioned in Deuteronomy 4:30, but he's talking about God being a consuming fire, even a jealous God. Okay? And he is. And he's talking about idol worship and not going into the promised land, everyone. And the curse that comes with that. Talks about corrupting yourselves with graven images. You know, those are false gods, or the likeness of anything, and shall do evil in the sight of the Lord thy God to provoke him to anger. Well, you know, a person or anything can become a god to you if it goes before God in your life. Okay? And this is what they did. They did this, and he scattered them. He divided the house of Israel. And nothing is more true than today that people are serving false gods, the work of men's hands, hello, wood and stone. And these things are inanimate, tangible objects. And he says they neither see, nor hear, nor eat, nor smell, but people worship them. Money, everyone. Gold. Silver. It says, but if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him. If thou seek him with all thy heart and with all thy soul. That's your entire being, everyone. You seek him. And, you know this is in the body of Christ. Because Christ says it is. There's other things that are before God to people. And they don't even see it. We've all done it. But God, hopefully by this time, has pulled you out of that deception. You know, this is where people even pervert the gospel and trick the body into believing lies and twist the word so badly and use perversion to do it so that people don't even realize their relationship that is to be with Christ. They talk out both sides of their mouths. And they try to say, if you call yourself the bride, that's a perverted thing. I'm going to tell you something. That is from Satan, the devil. It is. And we are to be preparing for a marriage feast, a marriage supper. We are. It is nothing perverted in that. Only human beings can pervert that because they have a dirty mind. So, we're going to go through tribulation. He's working out your salvation with you. In Deuteronomy 4:30, he says, when thou art in tribulation and all these things are come upon thee, even in the latter days, if thou turn to the Lord thy God and shall be obedient unto his voice. Well, his voice, it's his word, it's his spirit talking to you. For the Lord thy God is a merciful God. He will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee, neither forget the covenant of thy fathers, which he sware unto them. Okay. Well, now you're under the covenant of Christ. You are to be expected to be going to a wedding feast. Go read Matthew 22. And we're going to look at this word tribulation. Because I'll tell you, it's the word is sar, T-S-A-R in the Hebrew. And it means narrow. A tight place, such as in the figurative sense, trouble. Oh, also a pebble. Remember, count the number of the beast, everyone. The pebbles, the smooth worn stones, the black stone for conviction, the white stone for being found innocent. The same white stones that David left four of them, as he only used one out of the stream of the brook. It also means to be crowded by an opponent, an adversary, to be afflicted, affliction, anguish, distress, enemy, flint, foe, narrow, small, sorrow, strait, tribulation, trouble. A hard pebble. Such as flint. Well, It also comes from the word in the Hebrew, sarar. And it means to cramp, literally or figuratively, transitive or intransitive, an adversary, to be in affliction, to besiege, to bind up, to bring distress or be in distress, an enemy, narrower, like oppressing everyone. Remember the pressing, the purging, the birth. Think about a woman in travail, a woman having a birth. Oppress pangs, yes, like birth pangs, to be shut up, to be in straits, to be vexed with trouble. For someone to show hostility towards you, to treat with enmity, harassment, a harasser, a vexer, to suffer distress, to be bound up and tied up, to have little, to be cramped, to be in dire straits, to be bound up, tied up, and shut up, to make narrow, for cause distress, to press hard upon, to suffer distress. Well, didn't Jesus say your path will be narrow? Wide is the path of destruction. Means to press and to compress. To wrap up in a cloth or bundle. Well, that should bring to mind something. Smyrna. The church of Smyrna. Are hidden, wrapped up, hidden. Samuel 25:29 says, the life of my Lord shall be bound up in the bundle of the living with God, shall be under the protection of God. Well, it can also mean the same thing about iniquity, everyone. You know, there's a mystery of iniquity. There's a mystery of the kingdom. There's a mystery of Christ. There's a mystery of the gospel. There's a mystery. And if you don't know who you are in Christ, and why you go through what you go through, and what the plan is. You know, here's the thing. Here is the thing where you can get so confused by the lies and twisting of the truth of man. They will have you believe that if you go through tribulation, that if everything doesn't look all hunky-dory and perfect, that you're fallen, that you are not in the will of God, and nothing could be more farther from the truth, everyone. Nothing. If that is a lie that came straight out of the pulpits, it's not the truth of the word. And I'll tell you, it is what had my head so upside down for so long, because there's no spiritual understanding if you think that you're not going to have tribulation in your walk. That God will not allow tribulation or hard times. And that it's because of your lack of faith or your sin. No, it is to press out the oil. This is what is talking about when he talks about the 10 virgins. This has, you know, virgins has nothing to do with whether or not you've ever had sex. That's all in the physical, tangible thing. You can be a married man to a woman and be the Virgin of Bride. It has nothing to do with male or female. What did Christ say in the kingdom of heaven? There will be no giving in marriage. There will be no male and female marrying. There are no female angels now. They're male. They're sons of God. But yes, we have many that come here on this channel and pervert, and spout off how much they know, and they obviously do not even understand the basic concepts of the kingdom of heaven. They don't know the words of their own Savior. So, I pray for these souls, because they are beguiled and they are lost, and I'm sure they're the ones that think you don't go through anything. You are going to go through tribulation. Why? God has a purpose for it. And I can tell you, if your life has been all peachy keen, the devil's left you alone, and God has let you sit there and think you're blessed. You know, you don't know how blessed you are until he takes you out of a tribulation. You don't know how blessed you are until you're delivered. And that doesn't mean you won't go through another one. You go from glory to glory. Because he's working oil out of you. And this is why these five wise said to the five foolish, you go buy your own oil. Because they went through a pressing, everyone. They went through a pressing. They went through some stuff. All right, now let's look at this word. Tribulation. A little further. Because when we look at how this word sar has been used, and this is where we get the word czar, when you're talking about an oppressive ruler too, okay? Why they're called that. Well, it's used in the context of enemies. It's used in the context of against. Now, this is the Hebrew. The literal word of tribulation, it means adversaries. Well, who's our adversary? Satan and his minions. So, means distress. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried to my God, and he did hear my voice out of his temple, and my cry did enter into his ears. Well, we just heard in Revelation 7 that the Lord does hear our prayers. See, Satan is a tool. He has a purpose, or he would not exist still. He's used to embitter the bride of Christ, the body. And the body is the bride. And it doesn't matter, you know, when he's referring to the wife or the bride. Hey, you have to either one. You're either getting married or you're already married. Hello? And that doesn't, you don't get to marry Christ until you're with him. You don't go to the wedding feast before you're with him, everyone. You have to be in his presence. So frustrating. Something so simple cannot be understood. But when you put sexuality into it, well, you know, Now you know why the devil does what he does today. You know, he's got to pervert everything. He's got to make male and female and get their sexuality all confused, because then, you know, heaven forbid anyone understand that, right? So, you know, just like in Judges, the book of Judges, it says, go and cry unto the gods which you have chosen. Let them deliver you in the time of tribulation. You know, the Christ had tribulation. You think you won't? You're what if you're walking and you're doing what you are called to do, and you're following the will of God, you're going to have tribulation. It's quite the opposite of what man would have, you know, about the prosperity gospel and you know, everything, you know, you turn your life over to God and it's all going to be great. You know, we can't even get Christians to understand there is a supernatural, unseen enemy. No, we can't. We can't. And here's the sad thing. Those that are walking with Satan, I'm talking those that are seriously, seriously serving Satan. I'm not talking about a lost, poor sinner who has no idea what they're doing, or even one possessed, you know, that just got possession because they were out in the world and the world took them. No, I'm talking about actual people who oppress the people. I'm talking about the ones that are doing everything they can to get their father in. You think they don't know how to practice and operate in a supernatural manner? But yet the Christian doesn't even want to admit that these things exist. And if they do, they run. I'll tell you what, when you're dealing with someone who is seriously oppressed or even possessed with a devil, there's not many Christians that will come to your aid. There's not. They'll leave. They'll run. They're scared of it. They're not armored up for it. And that is why the body of Christ gets more and more oppressed. Because the spiritual war part, no one really gets it. Only a few. You have to admit something exists before you can even deal with it. And it does exist. So here we have Christians who still don't even believe in the spiritual realm. But they do. They do. And they're obedient. They're a lot more obedient than we are. They put their nose to the grindstone. They keep it there because they have an agenda. But then here are Christians, we're out here in the world, and we don't even see what we don't even see with our spiritual eyes. And that proves it to me when I hear all this stuff about the bride. And Christ clearly tells us what we are to him. Ugh. Wait till we get into Revelation and you find out really what's going on with the temple. It's going to blow your socks off when you think of it on a spiritual level. And if you don't have spiritual eyes, you're not going to see it. There's a virus in the body of Christ, everyone. There's a serious virus. Satan is like a virus. He operates just like one. And it is contagious. And if you're not inoculated with the Holy Spirit, then, you know, God help you. It's a shame that Christians don't think they're ever going to be potentially the ones that has the weeping and gnashing of teeth and wailing. When Christ says it's clearly going to happen in his church. That's what he's coming for. He's coming to cleanse the temple, and this is the final time he's cleansing it. And now it's the people. It's his body. It's his bride. And he's got to cleanse it. He's not going to take a bride that is not even understanding his kingdom to the best that you can find it out in his word and in your heart and in your spirit. This is what it's all about, everybody. It's about joining with our Lord and Savior, who is to be our husbandman, our kinsman redeemer. Has nothing to do with male or female. Doesn't see you in that light in your spiritual sense. Because you came from above. There is no female above. There's no female angels. They're male. Sons of God. There was no procreating in heaven. Wasn't a need. And that's why Adam came first, and out of his DNA came Eve. Because he created man in the likeness of the Elohim, God and the angels. All right, well, let's look at tribulation here. The first time it's mentioned is in Matthew 13:21 in the word actual tribulation. And it's talking about the seed of God, the seed of the word. And it's in the parable of the sower. This is Jesus Christ's words. It says, "Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which received the seed by the wayside. But he that received the seed into stony places, the same is he that heareth the word, and anon with joy receive it. Yet he not root himself in, but dureth for a while. For when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word, by and by he's offended." Well. So, what's this word? Tribulation. Thlipsis. What does it mean? It means a pressing, a pressure, pressing together, anguish, burdened, persecution, tribulation, trouble, metaphorically oppression, affliction, tribulation, distress, straits. Okay. It means pressing together of a pressure. It means the affliction of those that are hard-pressed by siege and the calamities of war. Well, we are in a spiritual war. And we're going into where the spiritual war is coming to earth. And there will be calamities of that war. Oh, the distress of a woman in childbirth. Imagine that. The afflictions which Christ had to undergo, and which therefore his followers must not shrink from. You run from it? Or do you count it all joy? It can be an anxiety burden of the heart to increase the misery of an imprisonment by causing anxiety. Okay, so this childbirth. Now, is this spiritual, or is this actually only a woman having a baby. Oh. No, it is in the spiritual sense of tribulation. So, does that mean a man that's male, will not go through tribulation? Because it could mean childbirth? No, it does not. It's talking about it in a spiritual sense. Because we as the body of Christ and the bride of Christ are going through a pressing. We're going through a delivery, a birth. We are being birthed. We are getting ready to go into a new dispensation, a new age, a new time. He's working out your salvation. It is painful. You will be oppressed. You will be attacked. You will have people take what you say and twist it. That is the mode of the day, everybody. That is in our faces every single day. So I hope that you understand here what we're talking about with tribulation, everyone. Because it is persecution. But he says, dureth for a while when tribulation or persecution ariseth. Mm-hmm. But we have to be rooted. We have to be rooted in him and rooted on the rock. What was the whole goal that Satan did to Job? To see if he would curse God. To see. Do you know when you speak a lie and pervert his word, you are cursing him? You're going against what he is saying. You're going against his plan. You're going against his plan for his church and his kingdom. So who are you yielding to when you do that? It's all to teach us a lesson. It's all to get our spirits to where we are able to be with Christ in his kingdom. Because I got news for you. The millennium is going to be boot camp. It is boot camp for Christ. It is his boot camp. He is going to be putting his house completely in order. He is going to get rid of the dead, the spiritually dead, those that walk with Satan. And they're going to be cast in the lake of fire so the Godhead can fully be put on this earth and the heavenly kingdom of our eternal home. And all that evil be done away with. All the lies, all the deceit. It's something magnificent to look forward to. So isn't that worth whatever we're going through now? Because I got news for you. The church will lie to you. The church will twist everything down around so that you, when you're blessed, you'll think you're cursed. And when you're cursed, you'll think you're blessed. You know, you don't come in and come into the body of Christ and accept Christ and your life gets all fixed. And you become perfect overnight. And that all the stones and tribulation and... Actually, you probably go through more. It'll look worse. Now, how many people would join up for that? Let me ask you something. When people sign up for the military, no matter what branch it is, are they signing up for a good time? Or do they know? Do they know they're going to go through rigid, rigid training? And then it's all, the main goal is to prepare you for war. For your job to man your station or whatever your place is in the army. Well, we got young people being so enticed by what the military promises that they forget what they're really signing up for. A lot of them go in for the free education and all the perks. And those wash out. They wash out. You want to be a washout? Because that's exactly what he's doing. He's getting ready to purge his church. It's in the process now. Right now is the time that he's giving us the space. The warnings are here. He's giving us the space to repent. He's giving us the space to figure out what do we still have to work on and work closely with him so that he can remove it or embed us. And what if he doesn't remove it? What if he doesn't remove your burden? And some carry some heavy ones. What if he doesn't deliver us from that situation until he returns or until he calls us home? Well, you better stay faithful to the death. That is what he said. You better be rooted on that rock, everyone, because this is what it's all about. This is what the parable of the sower is all about. So, do you see why Satan's doing what he's doing with everything that he's doing? Well, he's not. He's not in control. He's only allowed to go as far as he's allowed. Now, human beings have free will. So he can influence. He can get someone so messed up in the head that they take a life. Yeah. It's his beguilement. It's his deceit. And he is working hard in the body of Christ. But I'm sure most do not think Revelation 2 and 3 applies to today. Sure. Well, you know, they're going to find out. You don't get to just believe. Just believe and it'll all be perfect. Just believe. Well, yeah, you do have to believe. But you have to have faith in what his word says. You are to do your homework. And he's not going to give you many excuses to not do it, because he's given us the tools to dig as deep as we possibly can. So, this word tribulation, where is it used in the New Testament? What did Jesus say? These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Oh, remember this, what he says. John 16. He says, verily, verily, he's talking to his disciples here. He says, verily, verily, I say unto you that you shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice, and ye shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in travail, hath sorrow, because her hour is come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembereth no more the anguish, for the joy that a man is born into the world. And ye now therefore have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man taketh from you. Well, let's look at this joy. Joy. The word is kara. It's gladness. And, you know, when we talk about the fountains of living water, well, you know, that's your faith. That is joy, the joy of the Lord in your faith. And that's why the fountains of living water that is talked about in Revelation and other places, fountains are faith, everybody. It's pretty amazing. The fountains of water. Look and see what that word means. It's got everything to do with your joy. Remember the word was pege? A fountain, a spring, a well-fed spring. And it's the joy. It comes from the word G4078. Means to make fast, to fix, to bind together, to build by fastening. Well, fountains of living water, everybody. It's pretty amazing. It is your joy. It's your joy in the Lord. It's the faith. We'll go more into that when it gets into Revelation, but I just wanted to talk to you about this because we need to understand why we go through tribulation. And the church would have us believe so many lies about it. Really, it's true. Cheerfulness, calm delight, gladness, greatly, exceedingly joyful. Joy. Exactly what it's talking about. We are going to get, that's our goal, everyone. We're not going to have total experience of this until we return with our Lord and Savior. So now that we understand what we're doing and going through tribulation, now that we get this, we're just going to go back over the trumpets real quick and we're going to get into the woes because this is where it's going to get hard, really hard. And we have to prepare. We have to prepare for this. And we cannot be shaken. We must pray for our brethren because there are so many out there that are upside down, can't tell the forest for the trees, and it's sad. It's really sad. I'm not saying I have it all right. I don't know anyone who has it all right. But when it comes to certain doctrines that are just totally going to deceive the body of Christ, it is really scary. It's really scary because it should not be. It just should not be. It's the basis of our faith. These are the building blocks. We should be stopping playing with building blocks, okay? We should be beyond that. Like little toddlers don't have a clue what we're doing. Lord have mercy. All right, let's get into these overview of the trumpets and dig deep in these woe trumpets. Okay, so we're going to pick back up in Revelation 8, but we're going to do a quick recap on the chapter just so we can make sure we're caught up to where we were to be. And I had a problem with my internet. It keeps telling me my internet is off, and it's not, so we are going to go back to Revelation 8. Just going to recap the trumpets that we've covered so far. And I am going to remind you what we were talking about, and that was the opening of the seventh seal. Now remember, the seals are already opened, okay? Christ opened them. They are the blueprint, the timing of the events. And we spoke about how they go down. They're like a countdown. And so then the seven angels that stood before God, and they were given the seven trumpets. Then you had the angel that came and stood at the altar, and he offered up the prayers of the saints, all the saints, okay, with the incense. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then the angel took that censer, filled it with fire of the altar, and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings, lightnings, and an earthquake. Okay. The thunderings of God, you know, John was told to seal those up. And they're going to be revealed at a certain time before the return of Christ. And the word is Bronte, and it does mean thunder. And we know that the Lord's voice can sound like thunder, thundering trumpets, okay? So, there is just so much to delve into Revelation, or the Word of God, period, but it's amazing. And there were lightnings and an earthquake. So, we have proof right here that when something is happening in heaven, it does, you know, if it's thrown down on the earth, it does affect the earth, period. Spiritually and physically. All right, so we had the first angel sound. That was the hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees was burnt up, and all green grass burnt up, okay? So, remember the hail and fire. The fire is an amazing thing, because God is a consuming fire. He will burn off the dross, and the blood is the judgment. It's the judgment. This is God finally starting to throw down his warnings that his judgment is coming. And that's why I think sometimes when we know or watch and we see something magnificent happening with the weather, we are very saddened at the loss of life and those that are suffering, and we pray for those. But in our soul, we know that it's bringing us closer to a reminder of that time, such as this. And we know that then his kingdom is coming closer and closer. And yes, it is tribulation. It is. And, you know, God will use tribulation to strengthen our faith. He is burning off the dross. He's burning off the impurities that cannot be there, that hinder our walk and our faith. Okay. So then the second angel sounded. It was as a great mountain burning with fire, and it was cast into the sea, and the third of the part of the sea became blood. Well, remember we talked about this. It is spiritual and it is physical. I do believe this has to do with the volcano. I used to think it was an asteroid, but I really searched it, and much prayer, I do believe this is something in the waters, in the ocean, that is going to be blowing, and going to be tied to Joel chapter 2, and you know, that is what it's going to be going on. You know, he is going to be blowing a trumpet and trumpets and, you know, mountains. We know that in Joel chapter 2, verse 1, he talks about blowing a trumpet in his holy mountain. So, there are mountain ranges in the ocean, everyone. There are the biggest giant volcanoes are there. They make like what's on land as the super volcanoes. Nothing. They're huge. So, you do have to realize what God is doing in this time. And when it says all the green grass and a third of the trees is burnt up, this is spiritual also. It's also physical. But trees are dendrons. That's what it means in the Greek. And it's where we get the word, remember, dendrite, where I told you about your actual firings of your thoughts in your brain. and they look like trees. And the Lord does refer to us as green grass, as in the flesh. So it is something happening spiritual. It sure is. It is a deep, deep spiritual subject for this trumpet. But things will be happening in the physical. What manifests in the spiritual will also manifest in the physical, everyone. So, there's a lot being said here that if we just skimmed over it, we would not really think about it. So then we have the third part of the creatures, which were in the sea, and they had life, and they died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. That's a lot of ships, everybody. And I do believe that the actual armies of the beast will be using this time to their advantage. It will be a lot of calamity at one time, everybody. It will be the trumpets going off. It will be war. And we'll see those horsemen just, those seals of the horse, four horsemen, just flying open, coming to happen and occur. And we have not seen anything yet, everybody. And this is why it is so important right now that we get rooted in the truth, because there isn't going to be finding any truth until the Holy Spirit is poured out on all flesh, as is in Joel 2. And as we get further into Revelation, you're going to see what happens. You're going to see what God's doing. And if we don't understand the mystery, look, the answer to the mysteries, to all the mysteries, is in His Word. And it's through prayer and meditation on the Word and opening your spirit up to Him and receiving His Holy Spirit to get this understanding. And there is much confusion in the body of Christ right now. And I can tell you who the author of confusion is. It is Satan. And the famine is going to be for the truth of God. It is. And Christ is the author and finisher of our faith. And He wrote it, and He's going to finish it. And some just won't come out of these lies from the pit of hell that are being told in the body of Christ, and they're going to be burned away. Those lies are going to be burned away. And as we get further into Revelation, it's going to become apparent what is going on and how it all ends up. It's just amazing how God will reveal it and open it all up in this book. So, you know, many are going to be looking for a pre-tribulation rapture, and it's not going to happen. And they're going to have their faith tested by that. Many will, but many will go home first. But only the souls that are deemed to be here are going to be here. But there will be people who expected a rapture prior to the trumpets, and they're going to find out that didn't happen. And it will cause many to question their faith. But here's the thing. Here's why I don't argue this whole doctrine and of everything about the pre-tribulation rapture. Because you know what? I know the strength and the power of our Lord and His Holy Spirit. He's going to reveal what He would have people know. He knows what each soul needs to be brought under His will. And He knows exactly who's who. And He knows exactly what they need to be straightened out and to be told the truth. Okay? So, it upsets me when I hear the brethren who claim to be the elect start attacking those that believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. They will call them all kinds of names, even call them an apostate. That's some serious offense right there. You don't do that. Because, see, you're saying that your Lord and His Holy Spirit are not powerful enough to let a soul know something that it is deemed to know. Because they know, there's many Christians who believe in the pre-tribulation rapture, and they do know a lot of what God's Word says. And that Holy Spirit will reveal to them, they just got the timing wrong. And just because somebody got timing wrong doesn't make them an apostate. It doesn't mean they will take the mark of the beast either. Okay? You don't make that judgment. It's not our call. And if you've ever done that, you need to repent for it. Because it is very offensive to the Holy Spirit. It is saying that the Holy Spirit is not powerful enough to reveal to an individual the truth. So, I'm well aware that it's happened. And you believe me, if you've done that, and you think that you're in good standing with God after you've done that, you better go do some repenting. It's serious. It is saying that His Holy Spirit is not enough. You know, the book of Joel says that God will pour out His Spirit on all flesh. All flesh. Okay? Why do you think that when that those that took the mark of the beast cursed God? Mm-hmm. Why did they do that? Why did they curse God? They're not believers. Most of them are not believers. Think about that. And then, think about this. When that 7,000 are struck down at the great earthquake before the wrath of the Lamb, the remnant, many were frightened, and the remnant gave glory to God. Who's that remnant? Yeah, see, we think we know all the answers, but we just skip over these things. But we're going to get deep, deep into it when we get to those chapters. So, that's all I'm saying. So then comes the third angel. And it's a great star from heaven. Now this is a great star from heaven. Burning as it were a lamp. And it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. And the name of the star is called Wormwood. And a third part of the waters became wormwood. Now this is the waters of the earth. And many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. All right. But let's think about this. In verse 10, it says, and upon the fountains of waters. You know that's the ones that have faith, right? Yep. Because there's going to be a fountain of water coming out from under the throne in the millennium. And it is the joy. It is the joy. This is our faith. It's the joy of our faith. So you can see many are going to have their faith tested, burnt, fired up. They're going to be put in the fire at that time. God's going to be doing a work. Many are going to come out of confusion. Many of those that are sealed are going to stumble. Could it be that they believed in a pre-tribulation rapture? It's very possible. And then all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit just pours out on their flesh, and they're like, whoa! Yeah. Think about that. Okay. So, and we talked about this wormwood. We talked about, it was gall, bitterness. We talked about how it's tied to the the word Chernobyl in Russian, and how now we got Fukushima going on, but there's actually a star called Wormwood. We talked about the Red Dragon, Revelation 12. You know, if you missed it, please go back, because we went into it. So then we have the fourth angel, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. That's the sixth seal. That is the announcement of the coming of Satan. When Satan is making his appearance, it's a third. Everything's a third, a third, a third, a third. And we talked about why it's a third. Well, a third. He took a third of the angels and deceived them and caused them to follow him. And then you had a third that stood by and did nothing. And then you had a third who fought for God. Okay, so it's a representation of the souls. Okay? In the age that was before Adam, before man was put on the earth. All right, so this is the warning, because when Christ returns, it's all turned blocked out. Okay? And the reason it's blocked out is because there's no missing Christ. It goes from all the way from the east to the west. There is no, it takes up the whole sky, you know, of our atmosphere. There's no missing him. But when Satan comes, it's just a third. All right? And then verse 13, it says, and I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of other voices of the trumpets of the three angels which are yet to sound. These are the last three trumpets. They are the woe trumpets. Why? Because Satan is coming down to us, everybody. Mm-hmm. And these three trumpets are some really dark ones, all right? And what does the word woe mean? And it's repeated three times. Three times. Okay? Oh, and what's the word voice? The voice. Let's look at this. It says, and I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice. Okay? You put these two words together, you get megaphone, all right? But the word voice is phone, okay? And that means a sound, a tone of inanimate things as musical instruments, a voice, the sound of uttered words, speech, language. It's through the idea of disclosure. Mm-hmm. A tone. Bestial or artificial. Did you get that? An address, by implication, an address for any purpose of saying or language, a noise, a sound, a voice. Okay? So, the inanimate objects is the musical instruments. That's why it's referred to as the trumpets, everybody. And it's also a thunder. A thunder. You know, you can't help but when thunder happens after the lightning comes first, right? Then you have the thunder. And some of those thunder claps will just shake, jump you, make you jump. Okay, it's very alarming. And this is the thunder, the noise. It's also the noise of a millstone, of thronging the multitude, like in Revelation 19, of chariots, their wings, of the waters. It's an implying of speech through the sound. What are they doing with the phones, everybody? What are they using these for technology also? Just thinking. Okay, what else? A noise making, a clamor of men making a noisy demand. Oh, like the heathen raging? Mm-hmm, yes. It's also a cry, a wailing, a lamentation. A voice, the sound of uttered words. Those who begin to cry out or call to anyone are said. Yes. Crying out, shouting. Means it's a declaration from heaven that is heard through no speaker is seen, though no speaker is seen. You understand that? Isn't Satan copycat? Yeah. He uses technology. Wait till we get into that. And you find out about the image of the beast. Make an image to the beast. Okay? It can be a familiar sound of one's voice. The manner of speaking as a shepherd's cry or call to his sheep. See? To such voices, Jesus likens his precepts, approved, heard by all the good. Human utterance. The voice of a clamorous person. Okay? It's going to be lots of voices going on, guys. But it's God and his warning. It's warning, warning, warning. That's what, whoa, whoa, whoa. Warning, warning, warning. The sound of the words of Christ as he shall recall the dead to life. The resurrection cry. The awakening shout of the archangel, the leader of the angelic host. It can be teaching. It can be admonishing. Scriptures or the gospel. Old Testament or gospel. Shaking the earth. What happens when thunder claps loudly? You know? And we, as far as these thunderstorms, haven't seen anything yet. It's going to get bad, guys. It's going to be amazing. It is going to be amazing. It's going to decide whether or not you're bolted on the rock or you built your house on the sand. All right, now let's look at the word woe. So this word woe is repeated 3 times. Now, when God does something 3 times, he's saying something very important. That is why Christ would say certain things 3 times. That's why the Holy Spirit repeats things 3 times. This is why Paul prayed that God would take that messenger of Satan to buffet him 3 times. Okay? It's God's triune. 3 times. All right? This word woe means an exclamation of grief. Okay? It's an interjection of grief or of denunciation. Like as, alas, woe. Okay? It's thrice repeated. It sure is. And if it's twice repeated, it's a double witness, everybody. And God does everything with a witness. His truth is by the witness. Okay? And so it's definitely an exclamation. It also means of the evil of affliction of which is deplored. Okay? Well, this is warning you of that evil affliction that's coming. And it also can mean a divine penalty threatens me. Okay? Because he is going to be correcting during these trumpets. This is how some come out of confusion. Zerubbabel means coming out of confusion. Babylon. Babylon is confusion. There are many that are in the body of Christ right now that are falling into Babylon. It was, this election had everything to do with it, and so did the elections before this. It's been going on for a long time, but it really upped the ante when we got Obama and we got this last election. The people are imagining a vain thing. Who are the people? Okay, the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing. All right, the people are God's people. There are many that are imagining a vain thing. Why? Because they're looking to a vain man to give them what they want out of the system, to correct it. And we know there's only going to be one coming to correct with a rod of iron. The beast is building momentum. And it is the new world order. So the people actually push away the new world order that has been. And it's opening the door for the new world order. Okay? Because that first beast is going to get a deadly wound. And many are going to think it's going to be all come all glorious. And you know what? Many are going to be deceived to think it is glorious. It is going to be Satan's trying to set up a utopia. All right. And that's why he intermixed the faith and everything else. Well, let me ask you something. Why is Christianity so, so hated? Why is Christianity the only one that's not tolerated? Think about that. Think about that. Because it's the truth. And if you go any other way, you're a robber and a thief. All right. So, and I beheld an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, "Woe, woe, woe to woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are ready to sound." Okay. Well, these are your woes, and they are tied to the six woes of Isaiah. We will go to those in a bit, but we're going to cover these trumpets first. And let's see, now we're going to go into Revelation 9. Now, I'm going to read this out of the Greens, and we will be looking at the Hebrew also, okay? So, this Revelation 9 is the fifth angel, the fifth trumpet. And the fifth angel trumpeted, and I saw a star out of heaven, having fallen onto the earth, and the key to the pit of the abyss was given to it. Okay. Well, we had wormwood, okay, which was tied directly to the red dragon, which is Satan, all right? And so he's saying he saw this angel. Also, the star out of the heaven fallen onto the earth, and the key to the pit of the abyss was given to it. Well, many think this is Christ. Many think this is the angel of an angel, a good angel. There's much dispute about it, and they think it's the same angel that binds up Satan in the pit with the chain. At the millennium, the return after the return of Christ. And I'm not going to argue that fact that it is a good angel, bad angel, whatever. But I just want you to think of something. Just please think of something. And it says, I saw a star out of the heavens having fallen onto the earth. Okay, what are stars? They are angels. Okay? And it's coming from heaven. So we know it's an angel from heaven. Now, it falls. It doesn't say it comes down. It says it's fallen. Fallen. Such as in a fallen angel, everyone. I'm just saying. You know, it's a... Just please think of this. Look at this not the way you've been taught or you've heard it before. It is time to really look at the scriptures deeply, deeply. Because it says to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. Okay, we know this, that Christ holds the keys to death and hell, Hades. He holds them. So this was given. This key was given to him. Satan is the king of the bottomless pit. He's a Abaddon, Apollyon. So would it not make sense that he was given the key to this pit, to his the pit that he's the king over? Okay? Because he is going to be given power to go for a short space. But let's look at this word fall, a star, fall to heaven. And Greens, in the actual way it is written, it says, and I saw a star out of the heaven having fallen onto the earth, and the key to the pit of the abyss was given to it. Well, this word fall means through the idea of a lightning to fall, literally or figuratively, fall down, light on, okay? Let's look at it deeper in the context that it's used. It means to descend from a higher place to a lower. Okay, so it's coming from heaven down to earth. We are a lower place. And to fall either upon or from. to be thrust down, metaphorically, to fall under judgment, to come under condemnation, to descend from an erect to a prostrate position, to fall down, to be prostrated, to fall prostrate. Of those overcome by terror or astonishment or grief or under the attack of an evil spirit or of a falling dead suddenly, the dismemberment of a corpse by decay, to prostrate oneself, used of suppliants and persons rendering homage or worship to one, to fall out, to fall from, to perish or be lost, to fall down, to fall into ruin of buildings or walls, to be cast down from a state of prosperity, to fall from a state of uprightness, to perish, to come to an end, to disappear, to cease of virtue, to lose authority, to no longer to have force of sayings, precepts, to be removed from power by death, to fail of participating in, to miss a share in. So where do we see this word used again? Well, Satan used this word to Christ when he was in the wilderness being tested for 40 days and 40 nights. And Satan says to him, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just think about that. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying, it's just something to think about. And it's also used in the sower of the parable that we just covered. And then Matthew 15, it says, let them alone, they be blind leaders of the blind, and if the blind leadeth the blind, both shall fall into the ditch. All right, let's look and see where else it's used. See what the Lord says when he says, I beheld Satan fall like lightning. Okay? And Christ says this. Well, it's in Luke 10:18, and he says, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Okay? And it's the same word, pipto. Okay? I'm just asking you to consider this. But Christ says, behold, Luke 10:19, behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the powers of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Yes. And Jesus says, Jesus rejoiced in the Spirit and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. You know? Think about that. That's all I'm asking you. Okay? Because a lot of times we just go by what man teaches it and how he teaches it. And we don't consider what's really being said. So I'm just saying that. Okay? Just can consider that. And so the key to the pit of the abyss was given to it. Well, we know that he's thrown onto the earth. We know Satan is booted out onto the ground, the land, the earth. He does arise out of the sea when he appears as the second beast. He comes out of the sea of the people. Okay, and let's look at this word key. It's kleis, all right, and it says a key, a shutting, a lock, literatively or figuratively. Since the keeper of the keys has the power to open and to shut, metaphorically, it's to denote power and authority of various kinds. Well, we know that Christ is the key. And he is the key of David. It was how David encouraged himself. He saw Christ in the scriptures. This is how he obtained God's grace when before the cross. He was the lineage through which Christ would come. And Christ says, and he's talking to his church, and he says, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And this is why we pray the Lord's Prayer, what he says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And then what did he say? Woe unto you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You entered not in yourselves, and them that were entering in ye hindered. And then what did he say in Revelation 1:18? I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. He has them. He holds them. But this was given to it. I don't think it's Christ, because it's fallen. You understand? Christ is not fallen. Okay? Because this was given. The bottomless pit. And it doesn't say it's the same angel. Okay? Because in Revelation 9, it says the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth. And to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. In Revelation 20, it says, and I saw an angel come down from heaven. Come down. It's not the same word, guys. Having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. Okay? This word come down is katabaino. And it means to be sent. It's not the same word. It's like as at the temple of Jerusalem, from the city of Jerusalem, the celestial beings coming down to earth. To go down, to come down, to descend. Not fall. Not fall. See the difference? Descending and falling In the Greek are two different things. To be sent down. So it's not the same. This is a combination word. It's not the same as in Revelation 9. It's just not, guys. It is totally a different word. It's come down. Step down. Mm-hmm. Well, what did John 6:42 say? This is the Jews murmuring at Jesus when Jesus said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. And they said, is this not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he saith, I came down from heaven? You get it, guys? It's not the same word. See, this is why we have to be very astute in what we're saying is in the Greek. It's not the same word. And he says, Revelation 3:12, it says, him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. And Revelation 10:1, and I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head, and his face was as it was the sun, and his feet as pillars of fire. Do you see the difference, guys? There is a difference. Really is. It's not the same as falling. Coming down and falling are two different things. Okay, so he opened the pit of the abyss, and smoke went up out of the pit like smoke of a great furnace, and the sun was darkened in the air from the smoke of the pit. Okay, we've talked about this, that CERN is being used as a tool to do something. Okay? They are. It is. And you got to realize this is scientifically based, but it's doing something spiritual. It really is. It's doing something spiritual, everybody. It's darkness. And that's why they look for dark matter. Now, here's the thing. Working in science, I get this, okay, because I've seen how it works. When you're working with scientists, and there is a top, okay, that's like in corporate. These are the brains of the whole project, of what they know, what they want to achieve, and they write the protocols, okay? They give you the objective of the protocols. Each piece, it's divided up in departments, okay? Science is always divided up in departments, and each part has their piece in the project. But they don't really know what is the real goal. What is the real aim? It's very compartmentalized. Now, they can tell you what the goal is. They can tell you what they want you to believe the goal is. But it doesn't necessarily mean that's really what the upper echelon of corporate have designed. Okay? So that they do this in science to get people, especially at this time in science, because science and technology are being used for evil in a lot of ways, okay? Because this is the way it is with the beast. And this is why your top corporations, whether technology-based, science-based, medicine-based, they're all in it, whether they know it or not, okay? So each person, each group, department has an objective to reach. They might think they're doing their part for a specific reason, especially in scientific stuff like CERN. They are blinded. And believe me, CERN has an effect. It's going to have an effect on these people. They're playing with dark matter. All right. So they're spiritually going to be deceived and blinded and taken over. I mean, they're sitting over a temple of Apollyon. That's where they put this. Now, here's the thing about CERN. It's got other little branches of these colliders all over the earth. And what it's doing in Switzerland, I'm right there on the border, where the main Hadron Collider is sitting, does reverberate out to the others. And there are many here in the United States. Okay? They are doing something. And you cannot deny that something very dark spiritually is happening in our nation. Our nation alone. And there's a reason for that. Okay? So, it says, and he opened the pit of the abyss, and the smoke went out of the pit, the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun was darkened, and the air from the smoke of the pit. Listen, this darkness, it's darkness. This is opening up the pit that Abaddon is over. Now, what all's in this pit? What is in it? Well, we know it's locusts, but is it literally locusts? Let's think about Joel, the Northern Army. God's in control of it. See, it's not in control. And who do these locusts go after? They go after those without the seal of God, living God, in their foreheads. So they're going after people in the beast system, in the mark of the beast. Okay? Now, they're not just locusts. Okay? Now, this is demonics, everybody. This is demonics. They sting. Okay? Now, a locust, in the reality of the word, is a caterpillar. I mean, a grasshopper. Okay? A grasshopper. You know, we in North America call cicadas locusts. That's really not what they are. They're grasshoppers. So, but then it refers to them as scorpions. There's a reason for this. This is darkness. This is demonics. What are the demonics that are in the earth? It's the souls of the Geber, the giants, the Rephim. Because they could not return back to God. They could not. They were not created of God. And that is why he destroyed the earth with the flood. And Noah went into the ark. He was the only one that had not mixed with these fallen angels. They are the offspring of the fallen angels. Their souls could not be returned to God because they didn't come from God. And this is where we see demonics, possession, all this stuff. Okay, they have to have a warm body. They have to have it. Now, we know there's cloning. So you've got CERN opening the pit, which is another dimension. This is going to be the merging of dimensions, of the spiritual, of the unseen, and the seen. It's going to be ripping that protective veil God's had, protecting us. Though we could be oppressed, and there's people that are possessed, they're not like manifesting, like burst open. This is going to be all evil. All evil ever since the beginning of time dumped out on the earth. Satan's kingdom is coming to the earth. That's what this is. So it's very, very, very intense if we really dig this out. You guys are not going to believe this, but as I was teaching that, my dog got sick. So if you heard some weird noises, that was what that was. Okay. So, we know verse 3 of Revelation 9 says, and out of the smoke, locusts came forth to the earth, and authority was given to them in the scorpions of the earth, as the scorpions of earth have authority. Okay, they have authority. But do they have authority over you, that you're in Christ? Or do they have authority over me, as in Christ? We are in Christ. No, they do not. Remember what we just read in Luke 10. That's right. He says, I give you authority to tread on serpents and all manners of the enemy. Yeah. Wow. So, you know what? We have power over them. And they are not going to come, to afflict us. These are going under the command of God by his authority. See, here's what we got to realize, guys. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents. Well, who is the serpent? What is a serpent? And scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. But we're not to rejoice over that. We're to rejoice that our names are written in heaven. Okay, well, what's this word power? Well, it's dynamis. Dunamis. Okay? We would say dynamis. Like dynamite. It's where we get our word dynamite. Okay? This is dunamis. It's strength, power, ability, inherent power. Power residing in a thing by virtue of its nature, of or which a person or thing exerts and puts forth. Did you hear that word virtue? Mm-hmm. Virtue. that is how you're a virgin. It's by your virtue as being in Christ and being His and not being in the spiritual bed with Satan as Jezebel is. Okay? It also means a miraculous power that is in itself a miracle, an ability, an abundance, meaning mightily, deed, a worker of a miracle or miracles, power, strength, violence. Oh, violence. No, not violence that you go out and kill someone. Violence is spiritual. You know, the violent take it by force. Yes, this is spiritual. This is casting down demonics. It is. Do you see why Satan wears you down? He wants you to take your life. But he can't take it. It's not his to take. But he is death. You understand? But no one, he can do a horrific act, but no one can take a soul from this earth and a death of a flesh body without the or it being through the hands of Father who decides when you come home. Now bad things happen. Bad things happen. Accidents happen. So, this is dunamis. Well, let's think about what it just said in verse 2. It says, of 9, Revelation 9. Let's look at this. Let's look at it in the King James. And it says, the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. The air. It says the same thing in the greens from the manuscripts. And the sun was darkened and the air from the smoke of the pit. Okay, guys. Who is the prince of the air? The prince of the air. Well, it is Satan. And that's what Paul refers to him in Ephesians 2. But let's look at this out of the pit. Okay? As of a great furnace. All right? Would you not think that's coming out like almost a volcanic type of event? Think about that. And when a volcano blows, doesn't the sun and the air darken? Yeah, it does. Now, the air, it means just that, air. It's pronounced the same way as our English pronunciation. And it's talking about to breathe unconsciously. It's the air we breathe by respirations. Or analogy to blow, you know. Exactly like he said, his holy mountain, blow a trumpet, sound a trumpet in his holy mountain. It means the lower and denser air is distinguished from the higher and rarer air, the atmospheric region. Okay, so let's look at Ephesians 2. Okay, and it says, this is Paul speaking to the Ephesians, where in time past ye walked according to the course of this world. Okay, that is before you came and got serious with Christ, right? You walked according to the course of this world. Okay, that's being worldly. Now, the course means aeon. Okay, and it's a time. A period of time, an age. Okay? Even while the world, beginning of the world, and while the world began and without end. Okay? It's worldly, because the worldly ways are going to come to an end once Christ returns. But until then, it is a worldly system. All right? So, It says, in time past, you walked according to the course of this world, which the word is cosmos. So it's not just the earth, okay? It's the world, the cosmos. It's the whole circle of earthly goods, endowments, riches, advantages, pleasures, which although hollow and frail and fleeting, still stir desire and seduce from God and are obstacles to the cause of Christ. So it's an orderly arrangement. It's used in a wide or a narrow sense of the word, literally, figuratively, or morally. So it's worldly. It's being worldly, materialistic. Okay? We all were until Christ unblinded us and showed us. And it says, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. Okay? That the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. This is Satan. He's referring to Satan. He is the prince of the power of the air. Now, this word power is not dunamis, or where we get our word dynamite. It's exousia. What's the difference between dunamis and exousia? Well, I'll tell you. The difference between exousia, what exousia is, it is a physical mental power or a power of choice, a liberty. It is by permission, by power of authority. It's bestowed power. Okay? It's like ordained, given to by a higher authority. Okay? So God is letting him be the prince of this, prince of the power of the air. So is it any wonder? Is it any wonder he would use technology as we know it today, which we would not understand that 25 years ago? We would not have understood Wi-Fi, microwaves, cell phones, all this technology that has advanced over the last 20 years. We would not understand that back then. So we can see how he's using technology through the air, which lines completely up with Joel and the Locust Army, which we just read the other day about how they operate and how they go over the houses and through the city, and do you see they're being spiritually ruled? And technology ties completely in this. So it's also a sign of authority as a crown. Well, Satan has some crowns, everybody. Yes, he does. He has 10 of them. The great red dragon. And the beast. Do you get it? Well, you know, there are some that are in the body of Christ that have already earned their crown, but Jesus told them, let no man take your crown. Now, the Church of Smyrna, that was the Church of Philadelphia, the Church of Smyrna, he says, I will give you a crown. At the end of this tribulation, I will give you a crown. So we can see where one church has earned a crown. The other one has to earn a crown. Nobody knows who they are. You can't know. It's not for us to know till that time is revealed. No sense in even worrying about it, where you fit in. You know, when you're running a race, you're actually running a race. Yeah, sure. Your desire is to be at the top. You know, to finish at the top of the places. But you're only going to do what you're going to do, and you're only going to do what you're physically and spiritually allowed to do in the body of Christ. This is why Christ is head over his church. He says who goes where. And gives you the jurisdiction in his kingdom, in his army. Okay? So, I hope you're seeing the difference between dunamis and exousia. Because dunamis, this power to tread on scorpions, it's not the same word as this power of the prince of the air. It's not. But you can use exousia. You really can. You have exousia. Let's see. When we look at the one where it says, I give you and over all the power of the enemy, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. Well, that's exactly what comes out of the pit, guys. And the head is the serpent. So, here's the thing, though. What Jesus is saying to you in verse 19 of Luke 10, he's giving you both. It is exousia and dunamis. Yes. Yes. Because he says, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. That word power is exousia. The same word, that's G1849 in the Greek, that's the same word as the power of the prince of the air. It's physical and mental power. It's by permission. It is spiritual, but when you enact it, it becomes physical. He's giving you authority. Authority. Now, when he uses the word dunamis, he says, and over all power of the enemy. Over all the power of the enemy. That word is dunamis. So he's giving you exousia over dunamis, which is the strength and the power and the ability. But he also has exousia as the prince of the air. So now you can see why technology, they can mess with it. Or even when things are happening that are affecting the earth through the magnetic field, it can affect you. Now, where does he get this power to do miracles? Well, that's his dunamis, where he pulls down lightning. Okay? Satan. And it's also the same word in the Greek, this dunamis, is the same word that we say when we say the Lord's Prayer. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. What else is this word used for? Wonderful works. Matthew 7:22. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? So these people are the five foolish virgins. And he tells them, get away from me, you workers of iniquity. Do you see how important it is to purge and rend your heart to him right now and to repent? Myself included. He's revealing more and more to me every day. It's when you put your nose up in the air and you act like you've no further to go, you've not got anything to repent for, that you don't, you know, that's why we are not to throw stones at our brethren. We are to stand on the rock and the gospel. You don't tolerate anything that's going to cause your brethren to fall or to trip up. You don't do that. You have to set the record straight. But you do it out of love because you love your brethren and you see that they're deceived. And you do tell them the truth. And guess what? It will ring true at some point in time. You don't go beat your brother over the head. But you don't put up with blasphemy or a doctrine of a devil that tells someone that's something that's going to really pull them out of the kingdom and get them to believe something that affects their salvation. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's something. You know, when you know the truth, and it is something to affect their salvation, okay, such as missing the wedding supper, the wedding feast with Christ, and you've got them telling, getting hundreds and hundreds of people who also tell other people this stuff, you have to realize the responsibility you are taking if you take one of those little ones and get them to believe this. And you know you will be revealed the truth. You could cause that little one to fall and miss the wedding supper. If they're not preparing themselves to go to a wedding feast and to meet the bridegroom, well, I don't know. All I know is that these people are Christians who have even cast out demons in the name of Christ and done miracles. And he says to them, get away, I never knew you. Well, why is that? Obviously, they had faith. Obviously, they did something that slew their brethren, and they had not repented. They weren't seeing the truth. Because then he talks about the man that builds his house on a rock versus the guy that builds his house on the sand. A foolish man. Well, I'm going to say, the only thing I mean, it's awful foolish to think you're not going to a wedding supper. I know, it keeps coming up and coming up, and I apologize. But it's dangerous. It's very dangerous. And I say it because I don't want anyone that is in this body of Christ to have to experience Christ saying, I never knew you, depart from me, you that work iniquity. What's iniquity, guys? Well, the word is anomia. And it means lawlessness of ignorance because of violating it, contempt and violation of law, iniquity, wickedness. Well, are we under the law or are we under grace? We're under grace by his laws written on our hearts. And he gave us one specific commandment, and that is to love your brethren. And that if you are angry at your brother, you spiritually slay him and you're a murderer. That's the only thing I can think of. Because it's not talking about a reverse of grace. It's talking about what the commandments Christ gave us. This is Christ speaking. And what is more wicked than to pull a little one off the path of what they're trying to run for their race? This is the end of the race. You're running the race to go to a wedding feast. It's the goal. It has nothing to do with sexual perversion and physical sexuality. That is a filthy mind. that's like something the heathen would say. And then accuse me if that's what I'm saying? Oh, God forbid. God forbid. No, I won't have that. I won't. Because, you know, someone could just come by and read the comments and think that's what I'm saying by what they have said I said. That's dangerous. There's a price to pay for that. I'm speaking the truth from the gospel. I'm speaking it all the way back from the Old Testament. It was prophesied this way. The book of Ruth. It's all about that. So is the Song of Solomon. But it's spiritual. Nothing else. But her kinsman redeemer was a man she took to a husband. And that is just a type that happened. A story. A historical story to tell you of the hope. If you put sex in there, the act, you're already defiling your spiritual bed because you have got your mind in the gutter. Just saying. You see how Satan works within the body of Christ? You believe, you don't believe your Lord and Savior when he tells you there's going to be some who have, were Bible-thumping Christians who did casting out and did miracles in his name upon the power and the exousia and the dunamis he gives them, and then do something that shuts the door in their face. What else could it be than to get your brethren to err and to miss the wedding feast? Because these are the same that are the five foolish, who did not have enough oil in their lamps. The truth, the mystery of Christ, the mystery of the kingdom, the mystery of the gospel, and turn it into something physically nasty. Wicked? That's wickedness. And that's what iniquity is. It's wickedness. And that is wicked. That is wicked to imply that. And to say we're not the bride because of that. What kind of eyes do you have on? I'd say the world has gotten into your spirit. And you better cast it out. And you better repent. That's a warning. And that is out of love. Because I don't want to see any of my brethren. I don't want to see this day. But it's going to happen. Christ said it's going to. But I want to make sure I've done my part to pull anybody out of the fire. You know, some souls you just got to pull out of the fire. Weeping and gnashing and wailing. Oh, Lord. That is not going to be a pretty sound. Not at all. And one more thing about this, and I'm leaving it. Matthew 22 tells us what Christ said about the weeping and the gnashing of teeth and the wailing. Okay, and that is when he's talking about his marriage supper, okay, his marriage feast, and this is what happens. He's talking about the ones that have no wedding garment, and he says to them, friend, talking about, remember, we're friends of Jesus, a comrade, a mate, a partner, my good friend, a fellow friend. Yeah, this is someone in his body of Christ. And he says to them, friend, how camest thou in hither not having a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Oh, the servant was speechless. And then said the king, well, who's the king? It's Jesus Christ. To the servants. Who are the servants? The angels, the reapers. Yeah, look and see what this word servant is. He said to the servants, diakonos is the word in the Greek. It's servant of the king, a deacon, an attendant, a waiter at a table or other menial duties, a Christian teacher and a pastor, a deacon, minister, servant. All right. Talk about ministers, servants, servants, ministers, servants, servants. Oh, Lord, he's going to have his own, your own brethren have to throw you out. Oh, my gosh. Yeah, these are laborers, servants, okay? It could be the angels of the reapers. All right. He says to them, the king says to the servants, bind him hand and foot and take him away and cast him into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. See, this is exactly what it's talking about. It's talking about those who are not dressed for the wedding. They thought they weren't coming to a wedding. Oh, Lord, help us. Lord, help us. What did they think they were going to do? Fly away? Pre-tribulation rapture? Maybe. But what? The Holy Spirit can reveal that to you. This is something. Listen, he desires all of his body to be in the church of brotherly love. He does. That's what he told us to do. But there are some who have a purpose in Smyrna. Just saying. Gotta pray on this and repent. Repent. Because you are responsible for every soul you lead down a wrong path. You can't come to here and lead me off this path. I know what my objective is. I know where my goal is. You know, I know what to teach the ones that are here and to tell them. And that is, they're going to a wedding supper, a wedding feast. And if you've been beguiled by this, open your eyes, repent, have God speak to God now before time is up. You're believing someone who's defiling you. Because I'll tell you, that weeping and gnashing of teeth, you don't want to experience that. You don't. He says, cast him into the outer darkness. Oh, ouch. Isn't that like where the fallen angels are? Ya betcha. Weeping and gnashing of teeth? Yeah. He says it several times. He says it in Matthew 8. He says it in Matthew 13. He says it in Matthew 22, Matthew 24, Matthew 25. And cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. Yeah. And Luke 13. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you shall see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, and you yourselves are thrust out. You're going to be naked. Sitting in the millennium. Naked. Naked. And everyone's going to see your nakedness. Everyone. And you're not going to be walking around doing anything for the Lord without your robe on, which is your wedding garment, which was supposed to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. So, I don't know how anybody could twist that. I don't. You must have missed half the gospel and a whole lot of the Old Testament to not know what the heck is your objective as a servant in the body of Christ. Oh, Lord, help us. Well, we're spending too much time on this, so I'm going to move on. And so out of the smoke of the locusts come forth the earth, and authority was given them as the scorpions of the earth have authority. And it was said to them that they should not harm the grass of the earth. Well, they're obviously not regular locusts. Nor every green thing, nor every tree, except only the men which did not have the seal of God in their forehead, on their forehead, And it was given to them that they should not kill them, but that they be tormented 5 months, and their torment as the torment of a scorpion when it stings a man. So let's go to Joel chapter 2 so that we can look at this one more time. I know we've been there before, but let's do it again because it's really important. Okay, so we're at Joel chapter 2, and the reason I am going here again is because it really brings out the fifth trumpet when we look at it in detail. And believe me, we really need to look at it. We really, really do. So, with that said, I'm going to start reading, and I want you to keep in mind what we've just covered in the fifth trumpet, okay? Joel 2:1, blow ye the trumpet in Zion, and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh, for it is nigh at hand. Now this is talking about Jesus Christ returning, pouring out the wrath. It is focused on Jerusalem, okay? Now, in the meantime, from the first trumpet all the way up to the return of Christ, there is a lot going on in the world. Okay, you've got to remember that a lot of destruction has happened. A lot of people have gone home. And the population is greatly reduced. So it will be focused on Jerusalem. But that is because Jesus Christ is returning. But he's coming. His coming will totally cover the earth. Everyone will see it. But it is really focused on Jerusalem. And that's because that's where he's going to return. That's where he was crucified. And this is where Babylon is set up. Okay? But everything else has been destroyed up until this time. Okay? It's a focus of a central area of Jerusalem in the Middle East. And I do believe that at some point in time in the tribulation, especially when some are delivered up and have tribulation 10 days. Okay. You know, all of this is going to be going on in Jerusalem. So don't be shocked if you're one of the ones that are here and you end up being in Jerusalem. Just saying. Because it'll come out in the book of Revelation. It will. And you don't have to worry about how you're going to get there. Because if the Lord has a way for you to, and if his will is for you to be there for whatever purpose, he'll get you there. Because we are going to be in a supernatural time. Angels will be coming. You know, he will use the beast for some, for transportation. So I wouldn't worry about it. You know, we have no idea what's coming. We really don't. We are in this mindset of what we see right now, and believe me, everything's going to be revealed. All the technology will be revealed, things that our governments have hidden, their weapons of war are not going to be anything like we've seen before. So, just keep this in mind. Okay, verse 2, a day of darkness and of gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness as the morning spread upon the mountains, a great people and a strong, there hath not ever been the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations. Okay, guys, this is talking about the locust army. This is the fifth trumpet blowing. This is the darkness that will be revealed. And it's going to go across the land. And it says, in a great people and a strong, there hath not ever been the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations. Okay, let's look at what it's talking about. This strong people, a great people. Well, the word great is Rab, R-A-B, and it means exceedingly great, a captain, chief, elder, shipmaster, multitude, officer, plenteous, populous, prince, process of time sufficient. Okay, great, strong, abounding. This is an army, everybody. It's an army. And it says, a great people and a strong. Okay, the word is H6099. The word is Atsum, A-T-S-U-M. And it means powerful, like a paw, P-A-W, like a paw of an animal. By implication, numerous, feeble, great, mighty, must, strong, and robust, powerful. And it is talking about a people here. Okay? So this should let you know it says the powerful members of a lion, such as his claws, his teeth. The wretched fall into his claws, but others understand the whelps of the lion. It means numerous here. Okay? So, just keep that in mind. Just keep that in mind. We are talking about a people here. This is a demonic possession people. And, it says, a fire devoureth before them, and behind them a flame burneth. The land is as the Garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness. Yea, and nothing shall escape them. The appearance of them is the men, appearance of horses, and as horsemen, so shall they run. Okay? The horses are in here. The horsemen of the apocalypse. Mm-hmm. Like the noise of chariots on the tops of mountains shall they leap, like the noise of a flame of fire that devoureth the stubble, as a strong people set in battle array. Before their face the people shall become much pained. All faces shall gather blackness. Well, because it's spiritual. It's spiritual. It's demonic possession, everybody. I told you. They have to have a vessel. They have to have a vessel. They are going to tie everyone's mind together with the beast, which is everything to do with technology, war machines, and possessed people. They're all going to be one system. Okay? So why do you think they are cloning? Why do you think they are making chimeras? Why do you think they're changing DNA and there's such possession these days of human souls? Mm-hmm. Yeah. They will become one mind. You understand? But God's in control of them. Yeah. He's in control of the whole book of Revelation. He's in control of everything. Okay? And it says, like the noise of chariots on the tops of mountains shall they leap, like the noise of a flame of fire that devoureth the stubble, as a strong people set in battle array. Okay? This is about a war, everybody. There will be a war simultaneous with all this going on. It will. Don't let anybody fool you. And it says, that devoureth the stubble. Mm-hmm. Well, they're a fire. Like the noise of a flame of a fire, they shall leap. Have you ever seen a massive wildfire? I mean, is it any wonder this book, this page, was with Joel 2, chapter 1 and 2, was what was found in the fire of Gatlinburg? I'm just saying. Of a flame of fire that devoureth the stubble, as the strong people set in battle array. Okay. We know what the word strong means. It's a zoom, people. It's am. Okay. It's a nations. Okay. It's nations. It's countrymen. It's troops. A tribe. Such as those of Israel. Flock, folk, men, nation, people. Okay. Well, who are the two nations right now that are on the forefront? Well, it's the United States and it's Israel. The nation Israel that's in the Middle East right now. Okay? And we have always, until Barack Obama, well, not always. There have been some presidents that just did not really give full support to the nation of Israel. But the majority did. But none shunned them like Obama did. And now you have Trump, who is in their back pocket, or so he says. Okay, he's supporting them. And the one world system, the United Nations, totally is just obsessed in their thinking about Jerusalem. And that's their goal, is to divide it. There is going to be some outcomes because of that, everybody. So just keep this in mind, okay? It's going to be very interesting when you see it all get unfolded here. So it's going to be troops in attendance, figuratively a flock, men, nation, people. All right. Now, we are seeing, there's no doubt that when you see radical Islam and all this stuff going on with ISIS, and, you know, it always is somebody. It's always somebody. Some kind of organization that rises up out of radical Islam and becomes terrorists, and they murder the Christians in the Middle East, and you know, they blame 9/11 on this. I'm just saying, what's coming is going to make 9/11 look like nothing. It was a warning. It was a warning. All right? And it says, before their face, the people shall be much pained. All faces shall gather blackness. Listen, I'm going to tell you something about this technology that we're in. It does affect people. I'm sure you felt it affect you lately. Have you had a lot of problems with technology? Is it getting you frustrated? Do you remember when computers first came out and they never worked? They were so slow. And, you know, you would just get so frustrated. You'd feel like throwing that thing out the window. I know I did. I know I did. And it's only gotten better, but it also has gotten worse. Okay? Because you've got more technology. And it's all tied together. You've got the Wi-Fi now. You've got internet. You've got... It used to be... The network had to be together just in one consolidated place with a server. Well, now you've got worldwide connections, okay? So, it's faster, but it also has a lot more problems. And we've seen this on YouTube. You know, a lot of people that are trying to get the Christian word out, your searches only come up certain things. You're not getting specific answers that you would have gotten 2 years ago. It's controlling what you see in your searches. It has changed that dynamic completely. People don't get their alerts. People don't get their messages. But let me tell you something. Somebody sends you a negative message, you're going to sure get that one, okay? But someone give you love, support, prayers, you might not see it. You might not. But you have to remember, God's on the throne. He will prevail, and I've seen it. You know, he still makes a way. He still makes a way. So do not discount technology in here, because technology does have a direct influence on man. And you are going to see this with CERN. You are going to see this with the D-Wave quantum computer that does... it's pulling things out of the ether, everybody, in the air, okay? It is not a normal computer, and it is a biological computer. Yeah, and each one of us are in there, okay? The beast system has really, really gathered some strength, everyone. It's controlling everything that we see on the internet. It's programming, television programming. It's all about programming you. They're feeding it to everybody. I have completely quit watching television. As far as networks, cable. That's just me, because I can feel certain things that it wants to do. After this election, and God revealed to me, you know, I might turn the weather on or something, but I do that online. I haven't even been watching. I'm just deep in the study, and believe me, there is spirits in all of this. It does affect our souls. It does affect our spirits. It brings your soul down. It wants to go against God. Completely against God. Okay? I mean, it's getting to the point where the gate is getting so narrow. It really, truly is, everybody. So, it says, before their faces, the people shall be much pained. All faces shall gather blackness. Let's look at this in the Hebrew, okay? Now, it's talking about before their face. This is the locust army. The word is panim. Okay, it's H6440, and it means the faces. Faces of presence, the presence, or person. A face of seraphim or cherubim, the face of animals, the surface of the ground, before and behind, toward, in front of, forward, formerly, from before, time before. Okay, what is going on around us right now? Wi-Fi signals, technology. It's going through you and me. It's going through the walls. It's going all through the cities. It's going, now they've got, Google has, and Facebook are putting out these satellites so that everyone can get onto Facebook. Okay? It's Wi-Fi signals. So that it could go to the remotest part. Okay? Because they're using Facebook. They're using technology. Facebook is going to be our judgment in a lot of ways, everybody. Believe me. They are using this and building it and building it and building it. They entice you. It's to get you to sin, to gossip. And believe me, if you go on there and you're trying to spread the word of God and you share something, you're going to get very, very few responses. You're going to get very, very few thank yous or I enjoyed that. Thank you for sharing. You're not going to get a whole lot. You won't be popular on Facebook by spreading the good news and love. If you're not gossiping or you're not complaining or you're not murmuring, I'm just saying, it does not take off for you, okay? Just take notice of that. All right, so their faces, well, you know, the people shall be much pained. Before their faces, the people shall be much pained. Listen, it's spiritual and it's physical, guys. It is affecting human beings. So, before their face shall be much pained. This word is cool. C-H-U-W-L, but we pronounce it K-H-U-L. And it means to twist, whirl, dance, writhe, fear, tremble, travail, be in anguish, to be pained. Such as in a dance, a twist, to whirl about. To be distressed. That's what it's really talking about here. To be distressed, to be in much pain. To fall grievously with pain, fear, form, great, grieve, grievous, hope, look, make, be in pain, be much sore pain, shake, shapen, sorrowful, tarry, travail in pain, like a woman in travail and pain. To be patiently, carefully, wait patiently. Now, what does the Lord tell us? See, there's a double meaning in here. It also means to pervert, to be wounded. It means to turn around. Listen, God's going to plead with you face to face. He is going to protect you from this when you're in Him. And it's going to tell you, this is where you wait patiently. This is the patience of the saints, everybody. This is where you wait and watch. Wait and watch. He always told you to wait on the Lord, and Jesus told us to watch. Okay? Watch. This is what we need to be doing. And if you feel this stuff affecting you, I suggest you go to Psalm 69 and read it out loud, dig in deep, like we did the other day. Because I'm telling you, this is David praying about something evil, dark, bothering his soul, coming into his soul, it causing him to say things and do things that he regrets, that he has to repent for. I'm telling you, do not think you are alone if you're experiencing this. Don't think you are. But go to the Word. It may take you and make you want to go to your bed. It may take you and make you just give up. It may just take you and make you cold, feel cold. Okay, that's what it's designed to do. Blackness, darkness. Don't give in to it. Don't give in to that. Do what God would have you do. Go dig deep in His Word. Pour out your soul to Him. And if you can't find the words, recite the words of David. Okay? And Psalm 69 and Psalm 91, everyone. This is time. I am being shown some things that I'm not going to talk about yet. But I can tell you, I know something is changing drastically. And it's affecting our souls. And it's not the same. There has been a shift. And there's been several shifts. But this recent shift is big. Okay? Please trust me on this. I would never lie to you about this. So let's please go to Psalm 69 when you feel this. You're going to feel it. You're going to feel these things. This is not them in the full on attacking God's people. But I'm going to tell you, we are spiritual beings. Because they will go after those that take the mark. And they will torment man 5 months. Now that's interesting, isn't it? Because that is the same amount of time that Noah was in the ark, everybody, for the flood. So, and five is grace. Okay? So listen to me. We have to battle up. This is the patience of the saints. He is going to try to wear us out. But we have to stand on the exousia and the dunamis. But it is not easy. You're going to have to fight your flesh. You're going to have to fight what you're feeling in your soul. If you feel this darkness, if you feel it even affecting you, you know, you might even find yourself saying something you don't even know where that came from, okay? You might find all of a sudden you're irritated. I'll tell you what, put a bunch of people together in heat, sweaty conditions. Look at how people act differently according to what is the elements. You got more people agitated when they're all hot and thirsty and tired. Okay? We are still human beings. We're still in the flesh. So some of these things are still going to affect us. But we've got a trump card of God. And that has nothing to do with Donald Trump, by the way. We have something to pull out, the Holy Spirit. This is what David did. This is why David had a key. Okay, yes, he had the lineage, but he had more than that. He encouraged himself in the Lord. He repented. He was given grace in the sight of God before the cross ever happened. He recited the very words of our Lord and Savior in Psalm 22. He prophesied that 1,000 years, but his soul went through this. This is why in Psalm 69, he says, they gave me vinegar to drink. Well, what did they do to our Lord and Savior on the cross? You understand, he was tied. He was feeling the feelings. He was experiencing things in the spiritual that Christ would go through on the cross. Do you understand? We are all tied to that. So he is going to turn you around. This is what's going to turn you around, to plead with him face to face and wait on him and ask him to give you the patience. Believe me, it's a testing time. Okay? So it is waiting on the Lord, all right? You're going to have to wait on the Lord and have patience. So, all faces shall gather blackness. What's this word gather? It's kibbutz. Okay? And it means to assemble selves, to gather, to bring together, to heap, resort, to take up, collect, grasp. Like grasping with the hand. This is all faces. Okay, this is going to affect people. All right, this is spiritual darkness, everybody. Okay, and it says blackness. And the word is parur, H6289. And it means properly illuminated, i.e. is a glow a flush of anxiety. Blackness. Yeah. All faces withdraw brightness and grow pale with terror. Okay? They're going to see some really ungodly sights. They're going to see some real blackness, darkness. Okay? But you know what? To God be the glory, guys. God gets the glory over us. He will use what is meant for evil against us to our good. Just remember, you got to hang on to His word. I'm telling you, His promises. You know, He does want us to know them. Okay? Verse 7. They shall run like mighty men. They shall climb the wall like men of war, and they shall march, everyone on his ways, and they shall not break their ranks. Neither shall one thrust another. They shall walk, everyone in his path. And when they fall upon the sword, they shall not be wounded. They shall run to and fro in the city. They shall run upon the wall. They shall climb upon the houses. They shall enter at the windows like a thief. What is this technology that we're using right here, right now, for me to speak to you? Okay, and it does affect our spirits. It does. And this is what's going to take some over the edge. And the earth shall quake before them. The heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be dark. And the stars shall withdraw their shining. Listen, that hasn't happened yet. That's going to come later. But right now, we have got volcanoes blowing. This is coming up out of the bowels of the earth, everybody. Think about that. Think about that. There are souls bound in the earth, in the abyss, the bottomless pit. They're being released. We have not seen anything yet. There's going to be some major ones blowing. And then that's when the big dogs come out. Okay? We're already feeling this. Our earth is going through some serious changes, everybody. It really, really is. This is spiritual, and it's going to manifest physically. But these demonic beings have to have a vessel. So you're going to have it affecting mankind. But what is it doing to those that are in the dry? What is it those that are not given a human soul, where there's no resistance whatsoever, that have been created by man playing God? And why did God only take Noah and his family? Because they were the only ones that hadn't mixed. Everything was destroyed. Plant life, animal life, everything. Human beings that had mixed and been affected by these genetic alterations from the fallen angels. They were doing everything. They defiled everything in life. So much so, it grieved God that He ever created man. He grieved him. That's serious. And so there's a reason why Jesus says it's like the days of Noah. So I want you to keep that in mind. There are things that are completely walking around that are non-human. They are entities that were body empty vessels created by man, ungodly. It is going to bring down the end. It has to. And we know this exists. We know it does. They have things they're not telling us. They're not revealing. We know Dolly got cloned a long time ago. And it is no wonder that Dollywood figured in to this Gatlinburg fire that was simultaneous. When the first clone was Dolly, she was named after Dolly Parton. Because she was cloned out of a mammary gland. And then here we have Dollywood, Gatlinburg. But Dollywood got spared. She is a very Christian woman. She's always been a Christian woman. She does so much charity for people. She helped all those people that lost their homes in the fire and lost family. Yes, she did. So I'm just saying. I'm just saying, but boy, the fires were raging around that whole area. It's an amazing sight if you ever go back and look at the pictures and the videos. I'm just telling you, God uses these things to get your attention. So, you know, they have come a long way since cloning Dolly, the sheep. They've cloned a lot of things. They've created chimeras. These things have human DNA and animal DNA. And then you have those, look, Satan's coming to be the fake life giver. He's going to be acting like Jesus Christ. You think he's not got something up his sleeve to make you believe the dead are back to life? I'm just saying. Okay. Had some big earthquakes too. It says the earth shall quake before them. The heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be dark, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. Hey, that's when, that's the third of the darkness, the sixth trumpet. I mean, the sixth seal. Everybody. Okay, but it turns totally black before the Christ returns, because that's what happens. And the Lord shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great, for he is strong and executeth his word, for the day of the Lord is great and very terrible. Who can abide it? Listen, he's in control of this. God's in total control. The beast and all his little minions are on a leash. Who are they really going after? They're going after those that have, their DNA has been defiled, everybody. Think about that. Yeah. And then this is when God says, therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning. We should have been doing this for quite some time. Your soul should have been pulled to do this. If not, start now. Start now. And rend your heart and not your garments. And turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Listen, these things have affected us. They are affecting us. Okay, let's look at this word rend, because it means tear out your heart. Okay, the word is kara. And it means to tear it in pieces, tear it out, to rend asunder. Well, we better be cleansing our hearts. Tearing out these filthy, hardened hearts that are getting even more affected by what's going on around us spiritually. Mm-hmm. So if you find yourself getting agitated, you find yourself snapping, whatever, you know you got some more rending to do. Just keep on doing it. Keep on doing it. Keep on doing it. Keep on washing yourself in the living water. Keep on just asking Christ to cleanse you. Keep on doing it. Do it as an exercise, because every day you're picking up more of this. You got to dump it out. You got to keep rending your heart, rending your heart, rending your heart. Keep doing that up until the day he comes back. Tear it out. Don't let it take you to where you give up. You go re-encourage yourself in the word. You go lift yourself up with his word. That's what it's there for. That is the Holy Spirit. It touches all the way to the marrow of the bone. It changes everything. It changes your DNA. It changes everything. It's miraculous healing. This is the Holy Spirit. This is how it works. Reading the word, reciting it, and say it out loud. Say it out loud if you have the capacity and the ability to do it. Say it out loud, because it's very powerful. You know, God can read your mind. God can hear you when you pray silently. God can hear when you speak silently. But the devil can't. Burn him with it. Burn him. This word burns him. He'll run from it. He don't like it. Why do you think he comes against you so much when you're trying to study? Why do you think he comes against you when you're trying to spread the good news of the gospel and spread a warning? Why do you think he comes against you for that? Because he doesn't want it. He knows it's his demise. He really has no power over you. God's in control. It's who are you going to yield to? Who are you going to yield to? The darkness or the truth of the light? Jesus Christ and his word, the living word. We're just getting put in the fire, everybody. We're going to be a beautiful pot. And when he thumps us, we're going to sing. I'm going to take a break here, okay? And I'm going to come back. But I want you to chew on this. I want you to really think about it. I really, really do. I want you to just really, really take this and absorb it into your soul. And think about what is being said here and what is being revealed. Okay, God bless you. I love you all. And let's pray for one another, please. Let's pray hard for one another. And, you know, let's not have any more distractions, okay? I don't care if somebody comes on here and says whatever. I'll just dump it. I'm just done. Because it will affect our countenance, everybody. It will affect our spirits. If it comes not bearing the truth of Jesus Christ, it's not going to get read here, okay? It's just time to focus. Keep our eyes on Him. That's what the devil does. He'll use anybody that's weak, anybody who's having a moment. I'm telling you, just keep your eyes on Him. Keep your eyes on Him and on His Word. I love y'all. God bless you.